everything here is just fine. In my mind. Excuse me if I sing. My heart has found its wings. Searching high and low. And now at last I know.
Good morning. This is your boy, your dude, your number one listening voice. I was trying something new. I was just trying something new. That's all that was about. Good morning to you. You're listening to Coffee and Conversation with your boy, J-Mad on Spreaker.com, iHeartRadio, Spotify, and all the other platforms that we're on. Alexa, even Alexa can make it do just what it do. I hope you all had a great night's rest, and I hope you all have a beautiful cup of coffee in your hand. I made this cup of coffee this morning that is just banging. It really is. I can't wait till I start getting back to start doing my coffee and conversation back out in town. I prefer the Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A was a great spot to do my coffee and conversation. I can't wait to get back and start doing that. But again, welcome to Coffee and Conversation, and I hope that you all rested well. This morning, I have a simple, should I call it message? Let me do this. Let me see who's in the chat room. Good morning, Jackie. Good morning, Wanda. Make sure, y'all, we are praying for our sister, Michelle, in the loss of her mother. We're praying for her and the family. We are doing, if you wish to, LATC family is going to make sure that we send some flowers or something to Miss Michelle. So if you all want to be a part of that, good morning, Tony. Good morning to you, dear. if you all want to be a part of that, you may give to that cause at $LifeATC, $LifeATC. And thank you for those that have, that has already given. I do appreciate it. I really, really do appreciate it. So we're praying for Michelle and her family. I have a straightforward reach out to her, praying for her, and her family. Okay. I have is it a brief? I guess it will be a brief. I only do my 30-minute shows on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Which way? Okay. Hate the player, not the game. In life, we're going to go through things. We're going to have to face certain scenarios in life, and it is designed, it is purpose to shape us, form us, to mold us. One of the worst things you can do is not be pliable. Y'all didn't know I knew that word there. One of the worst things you can do in life is not be pliable. What is pliable? Clay is pliable. Putty is pliable. In other words, you can be shaped and molded. You can be shaped and molded without losing yourself. Okay. You can take the clay and you can bend it and mold it. And watch this. Even though they may take some of the pliable element away to shape it, they can still go back and reach some of that they already picked off and put it back on it and add more to you. But when you are wood, when you are non-pliable, when you are cement, when you are a piece of wood, if you're something solid steel, you're no longer pliable. You're no longer pliable, because if they have to shape you, they're going to have to cut away from you, and it's no longer a part of you. Life is designed to mold you and shape you, not break you. If you remain pliable, you will be shaped and not broken. I'm teaching way better than y'all responding. I understand. It hit me in the head too. And when it comes to who you are going to be, it takes everything that you've gone through in life to take you from stage to stage to stage, to mold you, to shape you into who you are destined to be. Not everything is going to go along with you. Yes, they in the pliable, when they're using clay on a board, pottery wheel. Yes, some of it, but majority of the clay stays. Are you willing to be pushed down? Watch this. Are you willing to be on the potter's wheel and let the potter do what he has to do? Let the potter do what he has to do in order to make you become who you're supposed to be. Watch this. When a potter has the clay on the wheel, he pays attention to everything that's going on within the clay. And if there is a mishap, even if there's a bubble, if there's a chunk or something like that in the clay, he will break the clay. He will push the clay all the way back down and start over. But the clay is still there. He never gets rid of the clay. He just said, I'll just push it back down and start it back over. I felt something within the clay that should not have been, that if when I put it in the oven, it would destroy the vessel it became. When I put it in, if I don't make it right before I put it in the cam. If I don't make it perfect before I put it in there, it's going to be destroyed once it get in there. It's going to have weaknesses once it get in there. So when it does become what it's supposed to be, it can be easily broken because the potter didn't do what he needed to do in the beginning. I feel it good right in through there. I do. While we're running around complaining about what we are going through, if you're gonna be upset with anybody, and my prayer is that you never be upset with God. I say that in a manner in which I used to be. There have been a few times that I was upset with God. And I was like, God, why are you doing? And I was upset with the player. And ignored the game. Ignored what he was doing. Ignored the fact that I went through this because I needed to learn this. I went through this pressure because he wanted to curve me in a certain direction. I went through this sharp edge because he wanted me to have a uniqueness about me. I felt this particular pain because he wanted me to understand and have compassion towards others. He put me through all of this stuff. He put me through the game. And I did not recognize what the player, I'm just calling God the player, the creator. I did not recognize what he was doing. But one thing about the creator, one thing about the potter, is the potter is not moved by the feelings of the clay. He does not concern himself if the clay is feeling some kind of way. The only thing the potter does is know what the clay is going to look like. He doesn't care. He doesn't consider, well, you know, I done built all this time with this clay. I might as well just keep going, even though he saw a little bubble in the little air pocket in the clay. He does not give any concern about the clay. He just know that the clay needs a certain thing. In order for it to last, in order for it to be at its peak, the potter knows I got to take care of the clay. For whatever reason in life, I already know what it is. Because of the selfishness in life, because of us being selfish in life, if we don't get what we want when we want it, how we want it, we become selfish. One of the most valuable lessons I've learned with my 47, going on 48 years of living, almost 35 years of preaching, I've learned this. Life is going to happen. And there is no need to sit and complain about life. It's not. I finally got to a place in life where I do not complain about life. I don't. I have no complaints about life. No matter what I've been through, no matter how people treat me, no matter how people talk about my name, no matter how people throw rumors about me, no matter whatever it is, I don't concern myself with my bank account. With financial issues. The enemy used to use financial stuff against me emotionally and spiritually. He would throw me off. Oh my God, he would throw me off. But when I got to the place where I started another thing, I hated when people did not when they looked bad on me, It was something I didn't do, and I didn't make them happy, or I didn't meet their standards, or I didn't reach the plateau, especially, man, in church. Oh my God. Let me tell y'all about church. I gave so much of myself to the church that I lost me. I had to meet their standard for what they wanted from me. That's the elder, that's overseer, that's pastor, da 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 da, and the list goes on. Got to the point where they was running around calling me bishop. And I had to keep up with their standard of what they required of me. And I was skipping stages that God needed me to go through. There's a saying. Watch this. And this is going to help somebody out. There's a saying that says, they say, I didn't choose the game. The game chose me. I don't know who that is for. I didn't choose. If you know my story, if most of y'all that knows my story, I accepted my calling very early on in life. I was preaching at 15 years old. I was already in the pulpit. I didn't ask for this, but I did say yes when he called. Let me talk to those who didn't choose the game, but the game chose you. When I say game, I'm talking about your destiny, your purpose in life. That's a better word. Your purpose in life. You didn't choose to do this, but let me help you all out. For those who the game chose them and they didn't choose the game, you still gonna have to go through some trials and tribulation, because everything that you have to teach, everything you have to minister, every brokenness you're going to have to fix, you are going to have to go through it yourself, which really sucks. You have to know what you are talking about, not something you read in a book. I'm talking about those that's walking in their purpose. In order for the best way to learn anything is by putting your hands to it and going through it. I'm going to say that again. You're supposed to put, when you get to the point, you should be putting your hand to the plow. There's a better word. I understand you didn't choose it. I didn't choose to preach. It is nothing that I would not wish preaching on my worst enemy. That's how bad it is. I would not wish this on my worst enemy. Worst thing you could say, a person could say to a preacher, and you're supposed to be a preacher, and you call yourself a pastor. Charles, give it, look, hate the player, not the game. We all have to go through some things. We all have to deal with some things in our lives. But if you are going to become who God wants you to be, understand that you have to go through some things. And the more we sit and complain about being on the potter's wheel, the longer it takes. Here's why. That when you are complaining about going through what you're going through, it makes it harder for God to do what he needs to do. Watch this. God does not make robots. God does not make robots. If you tell him to stop, he's going to stop. Then you're going to say, okay, God, I'm ready. I'm ready now. God, I want to do this. Now you in your feelings. And now you really want, because that passion never goes away. And now you're ready to become who God wants you to be. And God puts you right back on the potter's wheel. And you start going through some of the exact same thing over again. But you sit there and we start complaining all over again. This is too much pressure. Why you got to cut me over there? Why you have to do this? Why you have to do that? God, I don't want this. I didn't ask for this. That part right there. That statement right there. That statement right there. I didn't ask for this. Jackie says, but some things we don't have to go through if we stop being stubborn. I'm speaking to myself. And that is the truth. And that's the whole purpose of when we start complaining and you say, God, I want you. We are literally being stubborn. I don't want it. If you want to get on the court, if you want to go get on the football field, you're going to have to go through some training. We run around talking about, I am on the battlefield for my Lord. Before you get on the battlefield, let me help y'all out. Before you get on the battlefield, you have to go through boot camp. And boot camp is nothing more than a controlled environment. Did I say that right? It's nothing more than a controlled environment. Everything is staged. Those people are really there to protect you, even though it doesn't seem like that. What Job went through when he went through it, that was all a controlled environment. Yes, things was broken. Yes, things killed off. Yes, things. But his purpose, his real blessing came after him making it through the controlled environment. Are you willing to go through something to get something? Are you willing to go through it to get it? Are you willing to face you to get it? Are you willing to break yourself down? Are you willing to allow God to say, I need you to go through this? See, here's the thing. We oftentimes ask God, we'd sing this song. If there's any way, anything, God, you can use me type song, whatever the name of that song go, however that. If there's anything that you need, God, you can use me. And then we expect God to say, okay, that family over there need... that single mother over there needs some diapers and some formula. So we think that, oh, yeah, God, use me to do that. So you go to the store, get the baby some diapers and some formula. And we think, oh, yeah, God is using me. God is using me. Come here. I want you to come here. I want y'all to come here. Hey, everybody come here. Everybody come lean in closer to the radio. Sometimes God is going to make you go through a divorce. Sometimes you're going to lose somebody close to you. Sometimes you got to experience church. God is going to use you to experience church hurt. Sometimes God is going to use you to experience somebody mistreating you, mishandling, talking about you. And the list goes on and on. And we're sitting there. You may go through a health crisis. And then you say, God, why are you doing? What is this? Why aren't you answering my prayers? You said, I can use you any way I want to use you. That's what you told God. And when he does, we complain. Whenever I got 5 minutes. This is one of my favorite things to teach. What I'm getting ready to say. Whatever you are going through. Look for God's power, his presence, and his provision. No matter what you're going through in life. Look for God's power, his presence, and his provision. Everything in life, everything that you go through, understand God is using you. That's why I'm at a place in my life and people ask, you know, I try to help people out and they try to pick my brain and ask me, where do you get this peace from? Because I made it up in my mind that it's not about me. When you get to a place where you realize it's not about me, God is just using me. God may want to make a garden, and he want to use me as the hoe to dig up the garden, the plow to. And look, that means I got to do the work. That means I got to break up the rocks. When we think outside, let me help somebody out with this part right here. Think outside of the box. Define box. What you have learned through the years, especially about God, especially about the church, from the church. Think outside of the box. When you are able to free yourself to think outside of the box, what I'm really saying is make sure you have a complete conversation with God and ignore everything the church body, your denomination, your fellowship, your whatever your affiliation, your affirmations. Forget about what they say God is and who they say, because we've been looking for they. Forget about what they say God is or God should be to you. You should know for yourself. And God would tell you to do some strange things. Told Noah, build the ark because it's going to rain. It hadn't rained in years. And in the middle of a desert, Noah built an ark. People looked at him crazy, said, you ain't supposed to be. Why are you doing it? You just look foolish. They talked about him. They said he's going crazy. They said he's not a man of God. Forget all of that. When you are doing what God asks you to do, you will have that conversation. Take it from me. I know. But then you're able to say this. Whenever I'm found myself in a situation that I want to fight, God tells me, I hear God whisper, this fight is not yours. I got it. I'm just using you. This fight is not yours. Don't even worry about it. I got you. If you really want to be in this game, if you want to be where God wants you to be, remember, you have to let God use you. But he's not going to use you according to how you think he's going to use you. He's going to use you in a manner that will help the greater good. Because it's not about you at that time. Stop thinking your life is about you. Your job is to grow fruit on your tree. The fruit on your tree is not for you to eat. The fruit on your tree is for other people to eat. Your job is to take care of the tree, not the fruit. When you take care, because you are the tree, when we learn to take care of the tree, the fruit will come. People will come and eat from you. But watch this. Where does the tree get its strength, its water? From the ground, from the dirt, from the fertilizer. And what is fertilizer? Dung. You're going to have to be in the dirt. You're going to have to eat. Okay. You have to be covered in stuff. You're going to have to stink a little bit. But your tree, you're going to become stronger. There's a place in the Bible called Shittim. Shittim wood, and they grew trees. Shittim wood, Shittim was a place that just stinks. It was a nasty place. It was really stink. But they would go there to get the wood because they knew the wood was very strong. The wood was strong. That's why you're going through what you're going through. That's why you're dealing what you're dealing with. Because he has to cover you in some situation that stinks. But out of that stinkiness is the best fertilizer that makes your tree become stronger, which makes you produce better fruit, which you can feed somebody else. You can help somebody else survive. I'm just saying what I said when I said it out loud. Thank y'all so much for listening to your boy, J-Mad, on Coffee and Conversation this morning. I hope you enjoyed this. This song right here should bless somebody. I will see you all later. May God bless you. May God keep you. May you be so deep in the Lord that the enemy will never, ever find you. Holla at your boy. I holla.
He leads me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. When you become a believer, your spirit is made right. But sometimes, the soul doesn't get the notice. It has a hole in it due to things that's happened in the past, hurt, abuse, molestation. But we want to speak to you today and tell you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. Some people's actions are not because their spirit is wrong, but it's because the past has left a hole in their soul. May this wisdom help you get over your past and remind you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. I have my sister, Leandria, here. She's going to help me share this wisdom and tell this story.
Lord, deliver me, 'cause all I seem to do is hurt me.
Officially released. Now sing it for me, Leandria.